Thank you very much. The next item of business is a statement by Ivan McKee on a global capital investment plan. The Minister will take questions at the end of his statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Ivan McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, today the Scottish Government is publishing its first global capital investment plan, and I'm pleased to outline to Parliament how we intend to pivot to a purposeful and values-led approach to increasing levels of capital investment in our economy. Investing with purpose, our global capital investment plan is the third of three pillars focused on internationalising the Scottish economy. The first was a trading nation, our export growth plan, and the second was shaping Scotland's economy, our inward investment plan. All are framed by our vision for trade, which sets out our principles underpinning the trade and investment relationships we want Scotland to have now and in the future. And I'd like to take the opportunity at this stage to thank the team who have worked on this plan over the past months and the tremendous effort and work they've put into what I believe is a very productive and essential document. Private capital investment is the deployment of internationally mobile finance into a project or business in Scotland. This is different from inward investment or FDI, which seeks to attract foreign-owned companies to directly set up or expand operations in Scotland and so merits its own plan and focus. I am also very clear that it does not replace the crucial role of public investment or ownership. There are areas of our society that can, should and will remain funded solely by public sector investment, but we need to recognise that public sector investment alone will not be enough to respond to the challenges of the 21st century. This isn't policy for its own sake, but it's needed to deliver on our wider ambitions, particularly net zero. Capital investment directly impacts immediate economic outcomes, which then impact the Scottish economy in the longer term. The supply of private capital can help businesses realise their growth ambitions by removing key barriers to expansion. This impacts on productivity through better quality infrastructure, as well as through companies growing and having competitor or demonstrator impacts on their sectors. And there are further impacts through supply chain and wider economic activity. Scotland, like the rest of the UK, has suffered from historic underinvestment, which is seen as a key driver of slow productivity growth over past decades. Although it's hard to measure the direct impact of increasing private sector business investment to the overall level amongst OECD countries as a percentage of GDP could permanently increase the level of GDP by around 1.9% by 2030, more than £3 billion a year in current prices. And this could then increase average earnings in Scotland by almost 5%, around an additional £1,400 a year to the average Scottish employee in today's prices. So delivering on this plan has real economic consequences for Scotland's people and communities. In other words, this would be a very significant boost to recovery and a further long-term boost for Scotland's economy and well-being. To marshal that potential into a real investment-led recovery will require us to understand and engage with what makes a project, a business or a location viable in the eyes of the market. This plan seeks to increase the effective supply of capital by better understanding and targeting different sources of funding, to put forward our best market-ready opportunities using the strongest internationalised area in our economy to create demand for investment, and thirdly, to bridge the gap by taking action to increase the viability and fit of what private capital markets want to invest in and the attractiveness of our investment propositions. First, to the industry we need to work with. There's a wide range of investor categories, and within each type, a variety of individual investors, each with their own risk and reward preferences, timescales and investment mandates for individual funds. Our aim over time is to deepen our understanding of the needs of those different investors in order to offer better tactical and strategic matches to individual projects in Scotland. Global investors frequently seek a local investment partner, which both gives reassurance and helps overcome information asymmetries. We must not underestimate the importance of the Scottish National Investment Bank in this space, or of making much stronger connections with the investment management sector based in Scotland, which already manages £590 billion of assets. Scotland is already in a strong position to pivot towards impact, ethical or ESG investment. Scotland-based investment funds manage 11% of the UK's responsible investing market, compared to a 7% share of the conventional market. And this has formed a significant part of the sector's strong growth in recent decades. The time is right for us to become a global hub for ethical investment. Our inward investment plan identified the sectors in Scotland's economy which are globally competitive, crisis resilient and likely to offer growth which benefits the broader economy and society, as well as the business itself. The analysis on capital investment has identified broadly the same sectors, underscoring them as the best opportunities we have to use the global economy to build our domestic strengths. The plan summarises these opportunities into four sectoral themes: low carbon transition, health and life sciences, digital and high value manufacturing. These four sectors are the most likely drivers of future economic demand in the economy. They are broad, and that is deliberate, whilst the focus has been on those sectors which can drive growth and recovery precisely because they're already strong. This approach leaves space for different subsectors to develop and come to the fore over time, and for particular regional clusters of expertise to be brought out. We have set out from the beginning to align with and help deliver the private capital investment element of the investment needs identified in the Infrastructure Investment Plan, the Climate Change Plan and Housing to 2040. Presiding Officer, our commitment to net zero must underpin all that we do. We should no longer be putting public resource into originating, structuring and promoting investments in Scotland which are not aiming at net zero. By focusing on our priority sectors and employing a net zero and a place focus, we will be able to start to build demand which leads to viability. We can bring alignment between investments in business growth, infrastructure and commercial real estate with a focus on development rather than simply ownership, a change in ownership of assets. In other words, we will be building markets instead of just individual investment opportunities. We will expand and strengthen initiatives like the Green Investment Portfolio and the cross-organisational work to define projects for carbon capture and storage, heating and hydrogen. We should seek to systematically turn these into opportunities which are both commercially sound and structured in a way which supports a just transition. I'm aware that we are launching this plan while economic uncertainty around COVID-19 still remains. But now is not the time to sit back. We must be bold and support our businesses and projects with an investment-led recovery. Here and now, there is investment flowing into exciting and innovative companies, infrastructure projects and real estate. For example, European venture funds invested into Neurolabs, an early-stage computer vision startup, pioneering the use of synthetically generated data to develop object recognition models and opening up computer vision to a much wider range of applications. And although the real estate sector has been hard hit by the pandemic, there are major investments continuing, such as the £81.5 million investment into the Candle Riggs build-to-rent development in Glasgow. This ambitious plan contains 30 individual actions on how we will improve our approach towards leveraging in private capital. This includes proactively engaging with ESG investors and with sources of capital new to Scotland, such as green bonds, to help us achieve our net zero and wellbeing ambitions, establishing a new Series A fund for innovative companies, strengthening the pipeline of investment opportunities across public and private sector, and targeting a programme of domestic and international events and activities helping us to build new investor relationships. Through this plan, we recognise Scotland for the forward-looking, collaborative nation that it is. Together with partners in business, academia and the public sector, we can shape markets that are attractive to investors and encourage all partners to get behind this plan and help make it a success. I hereby am delighted to present Investing with Purpose, Scotland's Global Capital Investment Plan, to Parliament, and I'm happy to take questions on it from members. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. The Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in his statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we will move on to the next item of business. Can I remind members who have questions, please, to press your request to speak buttons now. And can I call Murdo Fraser?
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I thank the Minister for advance sight of his statement? And can I welcome the Scottish Government's focus on attracting private capital investment to help grow our economy post-COVID? That's an ambition we are very pleased to be able to support. Although I would just wonder how many international investors will be attracted to a country whose government is proposing another independence referendum in the course of 2021 with absolutely no certainty as to what currency they might be investing in should that come about. Can I ask two questions to the Minister? Firstly, what due diligence will be done on potential investors, given the recent unhappy experience we have seen the GFG Group, who are in serious financial difficulties? And secondly, whilst I welcome the emphasis on green growth that is in the Minister's paper, the oil and gas sector is still a very important part of the Scottish economy and a major employer, particularly in the northeast of the country. Can the Minister assure us that nothing in this new plan will discourage international investment in oil and gas?
Minister.
Thank you. Thank Murdo Fraser for the questions. And the answer to the first question is of course, the pound. With regards to due diligence, obviously the GFG scenario is a scenario that's impacted Scotland and the rest of the UK as well. Due diligence clearly is in place to assess those opportunities where the public sector is engaged. And I make no apology for the fact that we proactively work with investors to support and maintain industrial capacity within Scotland and mitigate those through the steps that are in place. And we'll see as that process moves forward. With regards to oil and gas, the sector is very well aware and fully engaged in the just transition to renewables. As I'm sure the member is aware, the focus clearly is towards a net zero transition. The sector understands that, and we engage closely with the sector to support the investments that lead in that direction, something that the sector, be that the majors or be that the supply chain that supports them, are fully engaged with and active in those investments in renewables themselves.
Call Daniel Johnson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Minister for advanced sight of his statement. Clearly, at a time of the global pandemic, looking forward and looking towards investment is hugely important. So while I welcome this report, I am concerned about the lack of specifics and details, including measurements of but both the potential size of such investment, but critically about learning the lack of detail about learning the lessons. As we've seen from the past, from foreign direct investment, from Timex to Michelin to the Cali Rail Works, such investment can leave industry at the mercy of decisions being made elsewhere. And when capital is removed, we see no long-lasting footprint in terms of jobs or industry. So can I ask, will the Scottish Government set out clear measures, both of the value it seeks to gain and more specifically targets for global investment? And given the issues of both FDI, but more specifically recent collapses of partnerships that the Scottish Government have been involved with, notably GFG, what work will be undertaken to learn those lessons and apply them to global investment partnerships that the Scottish Government enters into? And finally, how does this plan for investment square with the Scottish Government's decision in the budget passed just last week to reduce the level of funding for the Scottish National Investment Bank from £240 million to £205 million?
Minister Ivan McKee.
I thank Daniel Johnson for the questions. In terms of measurement, of course, measurement is hugely important in terms of how we track progress. And it will be well aware that this is something that I always endeavour to ensure as part of any plan we produce. If you look at Action 2 and Action 26, you will see that there is a commitment to put in place measurements, metrics to track our progress against the targets we've set for Scotland's economy with regards to the capital investment that we attract. So that is taken care of. With regards to the investments that take place, of course, what we're talking about here is private sector investment and private sector opportunities. That is something that the private sector clearly takes its own due diligence approach to. But of course, in situations where the public sector is also engaged, we would take steps, as we do, to put in place due diligence. That, of course, doesn't mean that every investment is always successful. The investment, by its nature, is a risk business. It's about understanding those risks, the reward balance, and understanding how to approach those, and having the thorough due diligence that allows you to be able to assess those risks and take appropriate action, and having the mitigating factors to be able to deal with any issues that arise with regards to those investments. investments, or you want a risk-based free approach to investment, you never invest. That's the reality of the situation. So I think I would welcome the members' comments in encouraging this this process going forward, and would welcome his commitment and support for what we're trying to achieve, and the recognition that as we come out of COVID, these steps are hugely important to the development of Scotland's economy.
I call Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the advanced sight of the Minister's statement on global capitalism. It was all very much in character. The Minister says that he wants Scotland to be a global hub for ethical investment. Does that mean that he will not be courting the interests of business entities which make any use of tax havens?
Minister.
I'm not quite sure where Patrick's going with this question. The reality is that private capital investment is hugely important to Scotland's economy. I've recognised that we are not in a position, nor would we want to be in a position, where every investment in every business or every piece of real estate or every other housing investment in the private sector or every piece of infrastructure in the private sector was funded by the government. So a recognition that private sector investment is important to Scotland's economy, I think, is clear, in any business that's seeking further investment from the private sector would, of course, recognise that. Of course, we are opposed to tax havens. We are that is not an approach that the Scottish Government welcomes. And if the members are alluding to our green pots, which I'm very happy to talk about, the reality is that we're very clear on all aspects of the green pots. We're not going to proceed with green pots if we're not in a position where we have conditionality around about fair work criteria, fair work first, where we have commitments around about robust plans, transition plans to net zero, and if there isn't proper governance and enforcement in place to ensure that the current environmental standards, workplace standards, enforcement standards around about tax and so on and so forth are in place as regards the rest of the economy.
I call Willie Wren.
The Minister is right that Scotland can offer good opportunities in ethical investment. This strategy may have been of assistance when the Scottish Government signed an agreement with Peter Zhang and Sen of Fortune, who promised a £10 billion investment in Scotland but had unanswered questions about human rights abuses abroad. So what concrete steps has the Minister taken to make sure the Government does not get drawn into such an embarrassing situation again?
Minister.
Willie Wren, I'm sure he'll be aware, because he follows these matters closely. We published our trade vision document recently in the Parliament, and answer questions on that, and that addresses these matters in great detail. And that trade vision, as we've been very clear, underpins all three of our internationalisation plans for Scotland's economy, be that our export plan, our FDI plan, or indeed this global capital investment plan. So taking steps to ensure human rights abuses are addressed as part of that due diligence process is something we articulated very clearly in the trade vision, and it's something we take forward every stage where we are engaged as public sector with investors that are seeking to come and invest in Scotland.
Thanks very much. Can I have succinct questions and answers, please? And I'll try and get everyone in. Kenneth Gibson, to be followed by Maurice Gould.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I warmly welcome the statement. Scotland has long suffered from chronic underinvestment impacting productivity, employment, growth and prosperity, as the Minister touched on. Which factors does he believe have most contributed to this, and how will he be tackled if Scotland is to build a much more resilient economy?
Minister.
Thank you very much. The investment purpose, our Global Capital Investment Plan, identifies the sectors in Scotland's economy that have demonstrated greatest resilience during periods of economic crisis and downturn. And they're also the sectors where we have a real international comparative advantage mapped to strong global demand. And the plan sets out how we'll pivot our approach to target more ESG or ethical investment. Globally, there's a strong move towards responsible investing, and the growth of these funds has even accelerated during the COVID-19 pandemic. So by focusing on these funds that have demonstrated not only resilience but growth during the pandemic, we can increase the likelihood of a steady supply of investment being available to Scottish businesses, which in turn supports wider economic resilience.
Maurice Golden, to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The Minister has said today that part of this plan is taking action to increase viability and fit of what private capital markets want to invest in and the attractiveness of our investment propositions. Does the Minister believe that the threat of an independence referendum this year makes Scotland an attractive investment proposition?
Minister.
Absolutely, because the opportunity that investors see from Scotland is able to attract to chart its own course in the world. When they look at the top 10 economies around the world by GDP per capita and realise that they are countries that are the same size to Scotland, but none of them has, bar none of them has, the strengths that Scotland has in terms of natural resources, the capacity that we have in the industrial sectors we've identified here, the skills base and university excellence that we have. None of them, bar none of them, have that, those advantages. They recognise that Scotland on its own, tracking its own future in the world, would be a tremendous tremendous proposition for them to invest in, to help partner with us and what will be a very successful Scotland and Scottish economy in an independent Scotland.
John Mason, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thanks very much. The Minister mentioned green ports, and I just wonder if he could expand on that. Is he particularly looking for investment into the green ports, or what would the relationship be with this kind of capital investment programme?
Minister.
Yeah, well, clearly it's a private capital investment plan. It's to support the structures whereby investors would seek out and be aware of investment opportunities in Scotland, and that applies across business investment, real estate investment and infrastructure investment, and green ports may be part of that. There's an obvious synergy between this plan and green ports, but our commitment to net zero and fair work, of course, underpins both. As the member knows, we are seeking to adapt the UK government's freeport model to better suit the Scottish context. We need to direct more public resource into originating, structuring and promoting investments in Scotland which support our transition to net zero and create new high quality fair work opportunities through infrastructure like green ports. And this plan can help us to attract the right investments for green ports. But we can't make any more progress in publishing our applicant prospectus for green ports due to an inordinate and an unacceptable delay by the UK government to finalise their parts of this plan. So there's now a very real risk that the pre-election period will begin in Scotland without the applicant prospectus for green ports being launched. Because of the UK government's delay and prevarication, and we see no obvious reason for this delay, I frankly am concerned, Presiding Officer, that this does suggest that the Tories' freeport policy may be about more of a race to the bottom because they have failed to commit to the requirements or red lines round about Fair Work First and the transition to net zero. So let me be clear, we in Scotland will not allow such a model here in Scotland, such a race to the bottom model, and we remain firmly committed to ensuring that Fair Work First and net zero are at the heart and underpin any green port model here in Scotland.
Colin Smith, to be followed by Bruce Croft.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Communities that would arguably benefit most from capital investment are peripheral rural areas that suffer weaker economic indicators, such as Dumfries and Galloway, the lowest wage economy in Scotland. So can the Minister tell us what action the government will take to seek to direct capital investment to those areas, and how will the effectiveness of such action be measured so the war on words on inclusive growth start to become a reality for local economies that are being left behind?
Minister.
Yeah, the regional aspect is hugely central to this, as it was to the Shaping Scotland's Economy, our FDI plan that we produced at the end of last year. And if the member reads through, he'll see that there's a focus on regional aspects throughout the plan. This is about understanding what Scotland has to offer and what the regions of Scotland have to offer, where their strengths lie, and then working with regions. And I've had great meetings with councils and economic development partners and others across Scotland on this, to understand where those strengths are, as we've articulated in the plan, and then to take those offers to the global capital market. So what this does is it allows regions like the south of Scotland that the member represents to have a route to market, to articulate the opportunities that they have for this capital investment, and to leverage the whole of Team Scotland through the work in this plan to help attract those investors to that particular region.
Bruce Crawford, to be followed by Graeme Simpson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I listened carefully to the answer the Minister just given to Colin Smith. Can the Minister provide further information on what steps can be taken to ensure the opportunities and benefits of such capital investment are spread across the whole of Scotland, and in particular to places like Stirling, which in terms of location and transport links is fantastically well placed to benefit from such investment, as well as, of course, being Scotland's first gigabyte city?
Minister.
Yeah, I thank Bruce Crawford for the question, and it really just allows me to reinforce the centrality of the regional approach to this capital investment plan. Global capital investment already impacts all regions of Scotland, not just the major cities or the central belt, and this plan has a specific focus on place and supporting economic opportunities that could be catalytic for local and regional economies. The place-based approach will further encourage investment in regions where there is already a sectoral advantage and build clusters and priority sectors where we know there will be future demand, such as the aquaculture life science cluster in Stirling, or and the Bruce mentioned other strengths that Stirling's economy already has to offer. So we will work to increase viability in these clusters, which will in turn bring investments to all parts of Scotland, including, of course, to Stirling.
Graeme Simpson, to be followed by Willie Coffey.
Thank you very much. The Minister will be well aware that the Scottish Government's track record of investing in private businesses is decidedly ropey. So bad, in fact, the Auditor General called on the Government to set out its future criteria for investing in companies. Now, this plan doesn't appear to do that. So when will the Minister publish such criteria?
Minister.
The member will be, well, first of all, it's a private capital investment plan. It's about attracting private capital into Scotland's economy. But the member will also know, if he's read the plan, the role of the Scottish National Investment Bank is a key part of that. And the member will be aware that the Scottish National Investment Bank is taking on the role across the public sector of pulling in all the other vehicles that have been used to invest public money into private businesses. Now, you talk about track record, there are many, many, many businesses across Scotland, and I meet them every week, who are very supportive of the fact that the public sector in Scotland has supported them in their growth journey. So there are many great success stories as a consequence of that. And the member will also be aware that the bank, the Scottish National Investment Bank, has as part of its operating mandate and other operating mechanisms, criteria to be able to assess and evaluate those investments.
Willie Coffey, to be followed by Claudia Beamish.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Could the Minister advise what steps the Government can take to ensure that any investments will translate into high-quality jobs for the people of Scotland? And in line with the previous questions from Bruce Crawford and Colin Smith, can I make a plea on behalf of my constituents in Kilmarnock and Irvine Valley, which has high levels of unemployment, that we might reasonably expect a share of those quality jobs too? Thank you.
Minister.
Thanks, Willie Coffey. Capital investment creates jobs in the economy, and this plan focuses our collective efforts around those four key sectors that our analysis has shown are the most likely drivers of future economic demand. Jobs in these sectors are primarily high-skilled, high-value jobs which pay higher than average wages, and the focus of our capital investment plan is about attracting investment into these sectors to create more job opportunities. For example, in the digital sector, the plan aligns with and supports the recommendations made in the Logan Review, which both highlights the importance of upskilling at all levels and upskilling traditionally underrepresented groups. And with regards to the opportunities that the Ayrshire Heart has to offer, the member will be well aware that I am fully aware of those opportunities, and I can let him know that I miss no opportunity to signal to global investors that they should come and have a look at Ayrshire, along with all other parts of Scotland.
Claudia Beamish, to be followed by Sandra Hoyle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. How will the Scottish Government help facilitate the shift from what risk being high carbon stranded assets to those sectors of the future? And will there be actual guarantees recognising both the just transition imperative and indeed to ensure low carbon outcomes? While I appreciate it's difficult with it being private investment, what robust measures and criteria will be in place?
Minister.
The member will be aware that right at the core of this plan is the transition to net zero, and we make it very clear that we have we are not anything we do in this regard has to be focused on ensuring that that transition moves forward. The sector, of course, as I've said earlier, is hugely engaged and supportive of that transition, and we work very closely with them to make sure that in terms of businesses, skills, communities, individuals and their families in parts of Scotland, that transition takes place in a way that allows those individuals and businesses to refocus their skills and efforts in the renewable sector. And the same applies to private capital investment. The focus here is on attracting private capital investment to invest in that net zero transition. We're very explicit about that, and we work hard to identify those investors, engage with them and attract them to Scotland, which is leading the world in many aspects of the transition to renewable energy.
Final question on the statement, Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Minister, earlier you mentioned GDP, a previous question answer. Now we know that GDP isn't the only measure of economic success. In fact, the recognition of well-being economies as shared by Scotland, New Zealand, Ireland and Wales is, in my mind, of paramount importance. Can I therefore ask how the Global Capital Investment Plan will fit with the Scottish Government's work to deliver a well-being economy?
Minister.
Thank you. The choices set in the plan explicitly seek to focus effort on attracting investment that generates wider spillover benefits and aligns with our values around good global citizenship, tackling climate change and increasing well-being. This type of investment creates high-quality jobs, which in turn supports our inclusive growth ambitions and improves well-being. Private investment in innovative businesses and infrastructure can have an impact on wider social goals by, for example, improving digital connectivity and supporting health innovation. In addition, increasing direct and sustaining investment in the low-carbon economy now will accelerate the transition to net zero. Not only will this reduce the impacts of climate change, it will also serve to create new industries and improve air quality and health outcomes. In addition to the projected impacts on GDP, the spillover impacts of increased private capital investment will also bring wider community impacts and support greater well-being.
Thank you very much, Minister. That concludes questions on the statement on a global capital investment plan, and we will move on in a moment to the next item of business. Can I remind members to follow social distancing measures in the chamber and beyond, and particularly when accessing and leaving their seats.